Hello, everyone, and thank you very much for joining us again. I said in the last segment, and I've said in a few other shows, I really don't intend on this being a show about Notre Dame or with constant Notre Dame people. That's the way it seems to turn out. Doesn't help. Doesn't hurt the cause. In fact, I went to Notre Dame, but anyway, there are some problems going on down at Notre Dame. We're not talking about just football problems. Matter of fact, we're not talking about them at all. There are a number of issues at Notre Dame, and they all go straight to the heart of the question of the Catholic identity at Notre Dame. Is it still there? And we're going to get right into this issue because it is a big one. Joining us right now is Michael Bradley, who is a senior at Notre Dame. Hello, Michael. How are you?
Good, Michael. How are you doing?
Doing very well. You know, it's kind of scary. You're going to graduate in 2014, right?
Yes, in May.
That's a little terrifying because I graduated in 83, so I graduated 31 years ago before you. That's awful. It shouldn't be allowed to happen. Michael is a very well-informed, smart chap who I've talked to a few times here, a couple hours actually, this past week on and off and over the weekend. And we've been talking about this question of the gay student body presence on Notre Dame's campus and as part of the fabric of the campus, but more to the point, how the university is receiving it, what it's doing, could you really say these sorts of things are in line with the way the university is handling this situation? Is this in line with Catholic teaching? I mean, that's really sort of the Catholic ethos. And Michael wrote an article which appeared in the Witherspoon Institute, really kind of blasting the university for saying, you know, for participating in National Coming Out Day. Now, we happen to know from some sources that there are some good Catholic leaders who are in the country here in the U.S. who are really upset about this because National Coming Out Day does not sort of speak to the heart of Catholicism and how Catholicism teaches and how it wants to help the souls of same-sex afflicted individuals. So, Michael, I'll let you take it away there. First of all, what inspired you to write that article about National Coming Out Day on campus?
What inspired me to write the article, Michael, was my walking into my residential dormitory at Dillon Hall, largest dorm on campus, and I saw a poster right inside the front door advertising Notre Dame's participation in the celebration of National Coming Out Day. And that really just sort of took me by surprise. I've never been a huge fan, at least during my time at Notre Dame, of how the university has handled these sorts of issues. But this really took me by surprise because, especially given all of the emphasis and all of the attention that the university had been focusing on wanting to be sound pastors to its students who struggle with these sorts of things, I was just surprised that the university decided that this was a sound and healthy step to take in helping its students. And so I wrote the piece for Public Discourse, hoping to bring some attention to the issue at Notre Dame, hoping to bring a larger conversation to this issue, not only at Notre Dame, but at, you know, Catholic institutions, Catholic universities in general, so that it could be discussed. Because in my mind, National Coming Out Day is not something that any Catholic university should be taking part in.
You made some very good points in your article that there's kind of a line, and the church certainly is with, as it is with people who have all sorts of different crosses and, mm-hmm. you know, things they have to struggle with. I mean, this is just one of, you know, many, many, many things that people can struggle with. So in this regard, for the culture to kind of express, hey, this is great, and, you know, you should come out and announce to the world that you have this particular, they don't view it as a cross, but nonetheless, you know, to celebrate this, coming out of the proverbial closet and announce to the world what your sexual inclinations are. How does that fly on a Catholic university? You met with, I've got your article up here in the Irish Rover, you met with the officials at Notre Dame who were kind of the, I guess you'd call them the steering committee, for lack of a better term, on how the university interacts and deals with this whole thing. And I don't know. I read through this. It's an interview where you just ask the questions and the two different ladies respond. And I got to tell you, I mean, it seems like both of them, one more than the other, doesn't really understand the teaching of the church here. And I'm not sure they ever actually come out and back it. They don't directly assault it and say, no, the church's teaching is wrong. But boy, if this is support for it, it's a certainly weak watered support. I mean, what's going on in the administration at Notre Dame where they just can, every year or every 2 years, there's a little more advancing to get to like a gay student club? And it's been going on like this for before you were born.
Yes, I think to start with, I think you make a great point when you say that really one of the chief problems of celebrating National Coming Out Day is not its particular relevance for students who identify as LGBT. It's the sort of this broader issue of why would we come out and celebrate anybody's inclinations, anybody's orientations, anyone's patterns of sexual attractions when those are patterns or inclinations or orientations that the church tells us are immoral or unhealthy or disordered at least. And so really, in my mind, what you see happen in Notre Dame with respect to a lot of these gay issues are just sort of the instantiations of a deeper, more underlying problem that Notre Dame shares with a lot of most places, indeed. Not quite understanding, it seems, the nature of the truths that the church wants to put forward, not quite understanding how to straddle this divide between the cultural understanding of the church's teachings and the church's own self-understanding. So that's the problem you've got to begin with, the sort of this deeper issue. With respect to the gay issues in particular, the university, in my opinion, struggles to maintain this balance between being a good pastor to its students and also, on the other hand, wanting to sort of be accepted, well admired by the broader higher educational community. And I've written about this in the past for the Irish Rover and through other venues, but in my mind, Notre Dame's desire to be well respected by the Ivy Leagues, et cetera, its peer institutions, is a desire that, if it's not tempered properly, can really get the university into some trouble. And I think with respect to the gay issues, this is an area in which the university has gotten into some trouble in the past couple of years.
In your run of your interview here, you interview two people. Maureen Doyle is the lady who was just hired to sort of be the coordinator. Just I'm getting all the university's official terms, but the coordinator of this group of gay student, a coordinator of a group to handle and help with the gay students on campus. She says one thing in here about, I don't know, halfway through your interview. She says, "We're," meaning the university, "we're also working on Stand Against Hate Week." As a Catholic, forget the fact that I'm a domer, as a Catholic, I hear that kind of language coming out of the mouth of somebody in a leadership position at the university. She was just hired this past summer for that leadership position. And she is immediately adopting the vocabulary. She's reaching into the lexicon of these groups. I mean, if there's any hate anywhere, it's the hate that many of these groups, these militant homosexual groups, exhibit towards the church. I mean, it's just such a falsity to say that, the church hates people who are gay. That's just ridiculous. But for her to use that kind of language and to stand against hate, who, you're immediately saying, well, yeah, we accept that people, you people hate them. How troubling is that? I mean, you read through this interview and it sounds like softened Democratic Party talking. Nancy Pelosi could have written this interview. It's troublesome that this is at Notre Dame.
The problem is that the rhetoric, I mean, as you said, of course Notre Dame stands against hate, as we well should as a Catholic university. The problem is that the rhetoric has been entirely co-opted in this debate in general by a secular agenda, by the gay lobby, so to speak. And so the problem is not that the words that are being used can't correspond to the realities that Notre Dame should be supporting and sort of trying to uphold amongst its student body. The problem is that, as you said, the lexicon has been captured by and twisted by folks who will construe those words to mean something other than what they really ought to mean. And I think really exhibit A of this example is Justice Kennedy's writing for the majority opinion this summer as he struck down DOMA. And Justice Kennedy says, basically, in effect, anybody who believes or holds what is the Catholic Church's view on marriage, basically, can only possibly be animated by bigotry, hatred, a desire to see others harmed, etc. And this is really ridiculous. And so one of the questions I tried to raise in the interview is, regardless of how Notre Dame wants to approach this issue on its own, try to set itself apart from what's happening in the culture at large, this is the language with which we're going to have this debate. And there's a lexicon that's there. There's a rhetoric and an understanding or a misunderstanding that's there, and you can't escape that. And so Notre Dame has to be very, very cautious in how it chooses to employ these sorts of terms as it discourses within its own community environment about these sorts of issues. It has to be very careful about that. And I agree with you that the language itself troubled me a bit, because it's used so imprecisely in so many areas that it can do more harm than good, I think.
Let me ask you, do you, and it's just a judgment call on your part. Do you think that many of the members of the administration who are backing all of these things. We're not talking about just the pastoral plan. It's, Bishop Rhodes there in Fort Wayne, South Bend, actually had a hand in the pastoral plan and wanting to make sure that the church's teachings, you know, were out there, that the church does love and care for, well, for everyone, but specifically in this regard, you know, her sons and daughters who have this particular, you know, cross to carry, and let's explain what the church's teachings are in this. So, but I'm not talking about just the pastoral plan that's been instituted. I'm talking about the whole atmosphere. You know, I was on campus one time, I think it was 2 years ago or 3 years ago, and half the student body was walking around on some gay celebration day. I don't remember what the cause was. They're all wearing those bright neon orange shirts. You know, I can't remember what they said. You know, I support gay, and the back said, I hate haters or something like that. And, and now the people's book bags, students' book bags have little pink triangle buttons on them and, you know, rainbow flags all over the place. And it's troubling. It's very troubling. And so my question to you is, given that atmosphere, it seems like not an unreasonable thing to conclude that the university is sort of presenting on one side a very formal, yes, we're very respectful of the church's teaching, and, oh, yes, we want to sit and talk about the pastoral plan. And, you know, that's sort of the red herring out there. While in reality, you know, most of the campus is supportive of this. You know, most of the faculty is like, yeah, gay rights, hey, you should get married, the whole bit. And do the people at Notre Dame who run the show, do you get the sense, in general, not just from your interview, that these people actually support the church's teaching with regard to this particular issue?
You know, that's an interesting question. With respect to the people who are directly involved with implementing these sorts of things, the pastoral plan, the folks who are involved with the review process, et cetera, I know for certain that some of those people who are involved do fully understand and support the church's teachings. Others, I suspect, actually don't. Of course, they'll pay it lip service, and that's understandable. They don't have another option at Notre Dame. But I do suspect that there are some involved, and again, and I don't have any particular names in mind, but this is the sense I get, especially from many of the professors. I mean, Notre Dame is a college. It's a university. What do you expect? And a lot of the people I don't think actually understand the church's teaching. Many people have actively spoken out against it at Notre Dame, professors, through other venues, not necessarily campus publications. But as you pointed out, Michael, the problem, the way I like to think about this is that Notre Dame can say what it wishes to say. It can give voice to the church's teaching. But is there fertile soil there in which the seed can fall and bear good fruit? And when the cultural soil, if you will, has been so badly corrupted, it's really difficult to do that. And given that soil, I think Notre Dame could exercise a little bit more prudence in the way in which it presents the message, you know, the seed, so to speak, so that it doesn't actually bear bad fruit by mistake.
I think a little history, even preceding your actually life, but certainly your time at Notre Dame, there has been a group at Notre Dame and St. Mary's of self-described gay alumni. It's the Gay and Lesbian Association of ND SMIC, St. Mary's College. Mm-hmm. And they have been around for decades. And every summer, Notre Dame has reunion for every fifth year. And, you know, so I graduated in 83. So in that, on every fifth summer, the class of 83 is back there, 88, 93, 98, and so it goes. And every summer, that group, Gala, however you say it, is on campus making seminar presentations, just like many, many, many other groups. And they have been actively working behind the scenes for decades to get the university to soften its, you know, stance, whatever that means, against gay students, and to get sexual orientation included into the whole non-discrimination work. I mean, they've been working at this for 30 years at least, and they've been encouraged in their work by many, many people inside the university, clergy as well. So let's boil this down to a Catholic question. You know, let's lay aside all the academic freedom chit chat and all that business, and let's get down to the brass tacks here. Do you feel, as a student there, you've been there 4 years, do you feel that the people who have care for the souls of these students really believe that and are really concerned about the eternal fate of these young men and women, and are taking active steps to help them overcome this problem, this evil that, you know, that we all have different evils in our lives that we have to overcome. Does Notre Dame care where these students spend eternity? Your take.
That's a powerful question to ask, Michael. Again, as I said before, honestly, some people do, some people don't. That's my honest opinion. And the problem, I think, is that of those who don't, or of those who do, rather, not enough of those people perhaps have enough pull in these sorts of university decisions. And especially when it comes to the moral formation, you know, I'm not, who am I to speak to the eternal fate of these folks' souls? But when it comes to the students' moral formation, I don't think enough efforts, enough serious efforts are being made from a pastoral perspective, from an educational perspective, from the classroom perspective, to really inform their students. And I do think that in many ways, some folks in Notre Dame have just given up on the project of doing that, because it's a difficult project. It's an inconvenient project, given the dominant ideologies that exist in collegiate cultures and environments. I do think that there's some fatigue. I think there's some capitulation to cultural expectations and mores. I think there's some desire for prestige behind all of this. I'd like to presume good faith where possible, but there are more things than that come into play, frankly.
So one last question for you, Michael, then. Do you, I'll ask you the second one, but do you, when you deal with your peers, when you write an article like this, when you publish this in the Irish Rover, I mean, the very fact that you're the editor-in-chief of the Irish Rover, I mean, come on, you know, that's the conservative, you know, lunatic, fringy, you know, not with it kind of crowd, right? what sort of blowback, if any, or treatment do you get for the positions that you hold and you publish these things and it's on the Witherspoon Institute page and, you know, all of this. And now here you are on a show where tens of thousands of people are going to watch it. And how do you find your personal going on campus because of your positions?
You know, there, I have two responses to that. The first is that I'm actually disappointed in how little blowback in general there's been. In my opinion, part of the problem is that not enough people care enough about these sorts of issues to take a stand on them, a definitive stand either way. Most importantly, there are a lot of students who feel the way I do about these issues, who for some reason don't see the import of these issues, or they just don't, or maybe they're afraid, I'm not certain. But there aren't enough students who do care about these issues who are willing to sort of speak out about them. And that's part of the problem, is that folks who believe what we do have been cowed into a sort of silence, a sort of submission, lest we be deemed intolerant, et cetera, and suffer the social consequences. So honestly, Michael, for a piece like this, I've received very little feedback from any students. Some professors have approached me. I'm sure that many students at Notre Dame who would read this piece would not agree with it. And I even have many students who are like-minded, who hold the church's teaching, who disagree with sort of my prudential judgment of National Coming Out Day and what it is. I think they're wrong in that respect. I think I've accurately assessed what NCOD is. So there's not enough student feedback in general, and that's actually part of the problem.
That's a little concerning. Okay, my last question for you is, we've got about 20 seconds left. You're going to be a senior, which means you're done. You're on a four-year program, right?
Yes.
Do you have a job in when you graduate? Got anything lined up yet?
Not yet. So if you're watching this show, please contact me.
All right. You just took the words out of my mouth. This is a bright young fellow here, folks. I mean, come on. There must be somebody out there watching this show. There's going to be 10 or 20,000 of you. What's your major, Michael?
Philosophy and theology.
Oh, come on. You need a brain like this in your outfit, whatever your outfit is, right? So hire him, start him at what, 120, 150,000?
Yeah, we'll start there and negotiate.
Yeah, they'll give you a signing bonus, throw you in, make sure you can take care of that. Michael Bradley, senior at Notre Dame, editor-in-chief of the Irish Rover. Thank you very much for coming on the show. Go Irish, right?
You're welcome. Thank you, Michael. Thank you for having me.
All right. God bless, Michael. All right. When we come back, we're going to have the Thomas More Law Center head honcho himself, Dick Thompson, here to talk about the church and morality and what is playing out in the courts. And boy, as my mother, God rest her soul, used to say, what this man doesn't know isn't worth knowing. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
My people suffer for lack of knowledge. Our Lord tells us this to remind us how important education is to our salvation. A premium account at churchmilitant.tv costs you only $10 a month. That premium account will get you access to hundreds of hours of catechesis and church history. As the rock of the church, St. Peter, reminds us, we must always be ready to give a reason for our hope. You'll definitely be able to do that as a churchmilitant.tv premium subscriber. Sign up today.
John Paul I was really murdered by John Paul II. Pius XII hated the Jews. Benedict was forced out of office.
The church has said, it is in the catechism, the church has always said, I'll quote the catechism now, no Catholic who is conscious of having committed a mortal sin is allowed to receive the Eucharist unless he first makes a sacramental confession of his sin to the priest. There's even a little bit of tautology there, slightly more words than you really need. A sacramental confession means to the priest, but they tossed in that notion more than you really need to make it theologically airtight, just to emphasize. I'm going to say it again. No Catholic who is conscious of having committed a mortal sin is allowed to receive the sacrament of the Eucharist unless he first makes a sacramental confession of his mortal sin or sins to the priest. So it really isn't okay. It's a horrible sacrilege.